Thank you very much, Children's Choir. And Brian, thank you for putting this together. And Jenny and Audra are great teachers. Thank you for doing all this as well. Welcome. Happy Easter to everyone. No matter who you are, where you are on life's journey, you're welcome here, whether in person, online. We welcome you to this special service where we're going to bring in a lot of new members and have a few baptisms as well. So I want to quickly go through the announcements today. Please sign the registers, if you will, at this time. And I want to thank Altar Notes, the Children's Choir, Brian, Thomas on drums, and Ellen on flute for being here today and helping us with this special Easter service. On your bulletin insert, you see the beautiful picture of our painting, and it's being unveiled today. The first human beings that are going to see it in all of its glory. It's right through the doors in there in Perkins Hall, and so peek in before you leave today to see that. We do have cards available for $2 a piece if you want a few cards to take with you. We will have those after the service. Our AED training is next Sunday at noon, and so 22 people have signed up, so thank you. We're all going to be very protected now in case anything happens, so thank you all for taking part in that. I forgot to put in, next Sunday is Holy Humor Sunday. We always do that after Easter. It's an ancient tradition of gathering to laugh at the devil for being, you know, not right about the crucifixion and the resurrection happened, and so we'll have a lot of jokes and talk about how laughter is very much a part of Easter. Snaffles the Clown will be here next week, so have the Snaffles is returning to us. We have a picture directory in the making, and so if you want your picture taken after the service, please go to Perkins Hall. You're never going to look any better than today, so I would go in there and see if you can get that done. April Mission News, we have our One Great Hour of Sharing offering this month, as we always do, and a lot of other announcements there, but we have a lot to do today, and so we have no time for any other announcements other than...
I was handed a piece of jewelry a little while ago. So if you have lost a chain, come to me after church, describe it. If you got it, it's yours.
So. Okay, thank you. So this is a very special day. We are welcoming new members and having a few baptisms. So all of you who are joining the church today, if you would stretch out across the front here, please. We ask you to come at this time, and we will all gather. Our baptismal family we will have right here, of course, by the baptismal font, but everyone else is coming, and you know, we have 15, so I have to, when you have 15 people, you're asked to come to the same place at the same time. Sometimes things can happen, so we'll see how many of the 15 that we get here today. So, Britt and family, if you want to come down this way, you'll be right here by the font. We'll have that ready. Okay, anybody counted yet for me? Who am I missing? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Okay, who's missing? Well, we'll find out as we go along. So on the back of your bulletin, we have just the briefest of introductions. I apologize, I didn't have much room to say a lot about each person, but I do want to say, and I think I know one already, Karen. Karen is not here, so you never know, something might have come up. So Karen will be joining, maybe she'll still come in and we'll have her join when she arrives. Jean.
There's two
Jeans. Yeah, two Jeans. Let's see. Ah, this is this Jean. Or no, it's that Jean. Yeah. So Jane is from California, retired from a water company as lab director of wastewater treatment. Isn't that something? So you learn stuff about each person as we introduce them. Aaron is here. Aaron is he's with the Arizona Department of Public Safety, so get to know him. He's a good person to know. A religious studies degree?
Yeah, NAU.
Now see, you learn things. So now that I know he has a religious studies degree, I'll be asking him to do some stuff for us. Andrea is here, and she is a Dignity Health employee, moved to the area in 2021, and has music interests. So somebody might want to ask her what that's about. Henry is here. Henry has been a great member already without even joining. He's a fifth grader at Del Rio, enjoys soccer, Legos, and Pokemon. And he's already done a bunch of stuff in the church, so welcome, Henry. Michael. Michael is down here. He is a HOA director. Pray for him. He is co-owner with Brittany of a digital marketing company, and he plays the guitar.
Oh, good.
So, Brittany Ann is here. She co-owns the digital marketing company. She takes care of Facebook for us already, so thank you for that. And she is a Courier columnist. How often is your column in?
Twice
a month. So twice a month she has a column in the paper. I encourage you to look at that. It's always interesting. And well, that's not a code word. It's it's actually very interesting.
You get feedback.
Yes. She, let's just say, she doesn't often fit into the Prescott mentality, if you think. So anyway, so thank you for joining us today, Brittany Ann. And then we have Star and Sky. And you don't want to mess with them either, because they study Brazilian jiu-jitsu. Jiu-jitsu. Yeah, so be careful. They are artists, fine artists. They do trail running and swimming, so I'm glad to have them with us. They've already been a great benefit to us as a family, so we welcome all of them. And then we have Susan. Susan, down here. Susan actually is Phil, related to Phil. Where is Phil? He's here. Yeah. So this is a special day. Merle passed away a couple years ago, and maybe a year or two ago, and so the cycle of life goes on. And so here we have her coming to be a part of our church family. She is actually employed in Ohio, one of those hybrid employees that can live one place and work another. And so I've lost my place. Where is she? Oh, there she is. Yeah, so welcome, Susan. And then we have Jean Murray. The other Jean. As a Minnesota connection, for those of you who are from Minnesota, and San Clemente, a Peace Corps volunteer in Thailand, of all things.
Many years ago.
And development and alumni communications employee at maybe two colleges?
University of Minnesota and UCSF.
University of Minnesota and University of California, San Francisco.
Development and fundraising.
So, yeah, talk to her about that afterwards. And then Dee Dee. Yes, right here. We're glad to have Dee Dee join us, San Diego area person. She retired from college bookstore in Chula Vista and has an accounting background. So welcome to you. Good to have you join us. Jan?
Right here.
Jan is here. She is from Orange County. By the way, there's a lot of Californians in this list, if you haven't noticed. Californians are welcome here. We don't scowl like the average Prescott person. She moved here with her partner, Kathy, 6 years ago, and they've been together 40 years. Wow. Where is Kathy's back here, so yeah, great thing. And she was involved in production control with computer companies. Yeah, so talk to her about that afterwards. And then Maury is here. Talk about somebody we need to pray for. Now, Maury is Yavapai County Administrator. Can you imagine? He has to make everybody happy, all the heads of all the departments of government, all the citizens of Yavapai County, and it's a huge county. So welcome to you. Angie and Maury came from Kansas, and so they've actually been elders and deacons in the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, which is our sister denomination. So it's like welcoming to the family today. And they enjoy hiking, which is a good thing to do if you're here in Prescott. Okay, Angie is retired visual merchandising. And we'll have to ask her what that exactly means. That's interesting. So everybody talk to her about that. And she is a para-education person with children with intellectual and developmental disabilities. So God bless you in that work. And I think we have a few other people who are have been or are involved in that, and so talk to Angie after the service about that. Okay, welcome. Welcome one and all. Now you, I say welcome, but you really haven't been fully welcomed yet because we have to ask you these questions. And so give you the test and the secret handshake and all of those things. So for the sake of our visitors, years ago we tried to take away barriers to join the church. Our thought was if you're following Jesus, would Jesus put up all these barriers to people coming in? You know, like you have to believe just this thing or that thing. And so we've narrowed it down to these two questions. Do you wish to join us as we follow in the way of Jesus, in the way of love and justice, do you?
Yes.
Will you become a member of this congregation using your gifts and talents here as you support the ministry of the church, will you?
Yes.
And all the rest of us as part of the church family, will we support all of these as they join into our family, encouraging them, befriending them, and helping them along their journey of faith as well? Will you?
Yes.
Thank you.
Amen.
Let us pray. Thank you, God, for these who are joining with us. What a marvelous Easter experience today as we continue to see new life in this church, which during COVID was very much depleted. And so thank you for how far you've brought us, and thank you for all these who bring their talents and gifts to us today. Bless them in this church family. May we be a blessing to them as well. Through Christ we pray. Amen. Okay, so now all of you can return to your seats except for our baptism family here. So apologize, I have to get something else. Do you wish to have anyone else join us? Any family members that want to join us, you're welcome to do so. Do we have our godparents too?
Okay.
Hello. Let's see. We just sort of gather here somehow. It's good to have all of you here. We have, as godparents today, Alessandra Hill and Marissa and David Rudder, who are here, and also family members. Oh, okay. Michael's parents are here, and your parents are here as well?
These are mine.
Oh, great.
She's our fault.
Well, she's been a real blessing, so thank you. Well, thank you all for coming. This is a special day, particularly on Easter Sunday, to have baptisms to welcome people into the family, Jesus' family, and our local church here. And so let me start with Star Marie, if you will come just right over here. Star Marie has been a blessing to us now for, gosh, how many months have you guys been here?
4 or 5 months,
yeah. And we're happy to have you as part of this family. And as we prepare for baptisms, let us pray together. Oh God, thank you for these opportunities to share baptism together. For Star, we pray that your blessing would be upon her now. May your grace be with her as she is baptized today. May your spirit be present as well. We pray through Christ. Amen. Star Marie, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You are a child of God, beloved by God, and you are part of our church family and part of Christ Church worldwide. May God bless you in your journey of faith. Amen.
Amen.
Sky? Sky has been a blessing to us already. She has done the difficult job of candle lighting, which, if you're visiting with us, to light our candles is probably the hardest job in the whole church. So thank you for enduring that and learning from it and doing it as you have. And so, again, we are blessed to have you as part of our church family. Sky Maria. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You are a child of God, beloved by God, and you are a part of our church family and of Christ Universal Church also. May God go with you on your journey of faith. Amen.
Amen.
This baptismal font comes from 1895. Our pastor at the time on the board back here, you'll see, is Du Bois Demarest. He was only a pastor here for 1 year, and then he passed away. And his family in New Jersey sent this out on the train for our baptismal font. So I always like to mention that. It weighs a ton. And, and so it's been a special blessing. We have two sacraments in our church, as in many Protestant churches. We have baptism and the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper feeds us on our journey. Baptism begins our journey and blesses us on it as we go forth. And so may God bless Star and Sky as they go forth in their journey of faith. Let us pray together. Thank you, O God, for this opportunity to gather and to welcome these new members and to have these baptisms today. Thank you for these family members who have come some distance to be with us today. Bless them and bless all of this family going forward. We pray through Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you all. God bless you. And I have baptismal certificates here.
Thank you.
You can hang those up in your rooms and be reminded of this moment. Thank you. Good to have all of you here. Well, now you get to officially welcome everyone, so let us stand and share the peace of Christ with one another. Want to lose that. Time for the children's time, and I thank you once again for singing for us today, and JJ and Ziggy have now come out of hiding, and they'll join us. So. All right, well, every Easter I have a tradition of bringing out my butterfly, who turns into a caterpillar. But now that it's 20-some years old, it's very difficult to make that happen. But I'm gonna try. It's getting stiffer, if you know what I mean, as you age. And so, on Easter, I always like to bring my caterpillar butterfly to remind us of how amazing God's ability is to bring new life or to bring change. So, you all know the caterpillar, right?
Yeah.
What happens? It's just amazing what a butterfly becomes. And I used to be able to put that inside there, but I'm going to kind of not have that happen today. Okay. Isn't that amazing? A caterpillar to a butterfly. Would you ever imagine that? And that's what Easter is all about. It's about using our imagination to think about what God's able to do with people who are alive, and then when they die, what God might do. Pets. Have you ever had a favorite pet? I had a favorite dog that died several years ago. I actually think he might have been an angel sent down to help me out. And so I think about him on this day, that God's able to take all living creatures and make them into new, as that's what Easter is all about. So take that with you today and think about how a caterpillar can become a butterfly. Wow. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for our boys and girls. Thank you for how much joy they bring us. They are indeed life, and they give life to us. And so bless them today on this Easter Sunday. Through Christ we pray. Amen. Thank you all for being here, and thank our teachers as always.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How fortunate we are to have Jenny and Audra as our teachers. They work across the street at the Discovery Gardens during the week, but come over here. And also to have a minister that cares so much about the kids. Prayer of invocation. Good news, God. Your angels appeared to the faithful women of Jesus' company, bringing the news more wonderful and awe-inspiring than they could imagine. Christ is risen. Surely your angels can interrupt our lives too. breaking into our losses and sorrows and offering a message of tremendous joy to change our lives. Come this Easter morning, we pray, and fill us with joy that our lives may be renewed in hope and glory. Let us roll back the stone of fear and doubt and experience the resurrected Christ once again. In Christ we pray. Amen. Please join me in the Easter acclamation. Christ is risen. Alleluia.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Now, if you'll stand, it's, you're presently able to sing the New Century Hymnal 233, Christ the Lord is risen today. Gospel reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you. So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. Greetings, he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me. Now we're joined in singing hymn number 237, I Come to the Garden Alone. Please stand as you are able.
Please be seated. Are we more than a sarcophagus planter? Strange sermon title, but it comes from a trip we made to London and then taking the train up to York several years ago. And we toured Old Town, which was an old Roman development, and the Roman walls you could see. And then there were these sarcophagi spread around that could not be removed by law. And so the people had become very creative since they had to look at them all the time, and so they planted flowers in them. So when I saw that as a weird preacher, I thought, there is my sermon title for Easter. Are we more than a sarcophagus planter? In other words, is there something beyond here? And so each Easter we gather to use our imaginations and to think about what might be after this life. Now we all gather with different ideas on that, whether you're a believer, a non-believer, a scoffer, whatever you are, you're welcome here. I would just ask you to think of the possibilities, to use your imagination, to think about what might be ahead for us. Some people aren't very good at using their imagination, and some people aren't very good at thinking of the possibilities. They can only see the problems. There was a rabbi, a priest, and a Protestant minister. Let's call him Pastor J. All three of them were facing the guillotine. The rabbi is placed in the guillotine and looking up at the blade. The gesture was given to lower the blade, and it got caught up. Everybody thought this must be a miracle, and so they let the rabbi go. Next, the Catholic priest. Same thing, they said to lower it, it got caught up. He too was thought to be a miracle worker, and he was let go. And then it was Pastor Jay's turn. He got in the guillotine, and they were about to lower the blade, and he looked up and said, "I see the problem." Don't be like Pastor Jay and lose your head. Some people are only good at seeing the problems. By the way, you can use that in your family gatherings if you want to. If you have that certain family member that's always seeing the problem instead of the possibilities. Yeah, so it's a day to think and to imagine and to think about the possibilities. You know, every Easter I try to share that in addition to the resurrection of Jesus, we all have had some strange experiences probably in our life where the other side has broken in. We've had maybe voices, maybe we've actually had visits, as I've heard throughout the years. And so I always like to say that we own two houses where it had to be disclosed that there was a ghost in the house. This is an actual thing that happens. And so when you go to sell your house, you guys disclose that. And so we bought a house in Old Louisville from the 1890s, and it was disclosed that we had a knocking ghost. Now, most of these experiences are not frightening, you know, or terrible. They're kind of weird in a way. And so our knocking ghost would knock. And so sometimes, you know, you would hear the knock, and okay. And so we had that. And then we moved here to Mount Vernon in a 1920s house, and they had to disclose that we have a ghost there also. It was a woman, and she lived on the second floor, and the woman that had the house lived on the first floor, probably hardly ever went up there, and so the ghost said, "Hey, I'm taking over up here. This is my spot." And so they had all kinds of strange experiences of that, voices, sometimes windows mysteriously open without anybody knowing. And so when we bought it, we had a guy that worked on it for a while, and he was there by himself most of the time. You know, he had no reason to think about any of this, but he kept hearing noises, and he would tell us about it. And we were like, "Oh, that's kind of strange." Well, then we kind of took over the whole house, and I think the ghost said, "I'm out of here. There's too much noise in this place. I'm taking off and going somewhere else." But, yeah, we have all these strange experiences. So, resurrection, new life, maybe it's possible. Who knows? So the other day I heard the best illustration for resurrection that I've heard in a while, and it relates to our cell phone. We kind of live with our cell phone now. It's a part of us, right? You remember those days in the late 90s when we had the huge phone? It was about that big and that wide, and you couldn't put it in your pocket, that's for sure, but we would carry it around, right? Well, then you remember in the, probably 10 years ago, we would want to get a new phone, and we would take it in, and we'd have to sit there for an hour while the guy tried to transfer the information from one phone to another. Now, what happens? You've got your old phone that the battery's kind of going away and it's getting old. It's probably cracked several places because we've dropped it so much. And so we go in to get a new phone. They just sit them right beside each other, and mysteriously, all the data comes over. beautiful picture of the resurrection. The old body that's wore out, got some cracks, doesn't quite work anymore the way it should, and you get a whole new body for your phone. There's Easter message right there. I don't know what we're going to do when they move to a watch or glasses. That's coming. But and then we'll look back and laugh at our, you know, like we laughed at our big phone, we'll laugh at this stupid device we have to carry around and are a slave to all the time. They'll look back. How did those people do that? You know, we don't have to do that anymore. Well, anyway, there's your picture of resurrection. Yeah, so open your imagination today. As I mentioned, I think my dog might have been an angel sent down to be with me, because there's a lot of mysterious stuff with that dog, and maybe you've had those kind of experiences too. But it's a wonderful day to think about the hope of eternal life, and for those that we love that have gone on to imagine, use our imagination and the possibilities of them being, I like to think of it as they're right next to us in another dimension rather than up or down or wherever. Just right next to us in another dimension. They're here in our balcony as well. Well, today we have Matthew's account of the resurrection. Each gospel has different things that it chooses to focus on. Matthew has two. He has the women being the first ones to come to the empty tomb, and then he has this earthquake. And so I want to just say a brief word about each one. First, the women coming first to the tomb. And the women of the congregation always say, well, of course, right? You can't rely on those men to do anything. And so that's been the history of the church, by and large. The women have pretty much been the ones to keep it going. They're always the ones that are there. The men are sleeping or hunting, whatever they're doing. But the women have been the ones to keep the church going. I always have to tell this story when I say this every 3 years. There were three men who came to a raging stream, and they were trying to get across, and they didn't know how they were going to do it. And so the first one prayed, God, give me the strength to cross this stream. And so, poof, he was given big legs and big arms, and he waded out into the water, and he struggled, but he made it to the other side. The second man, seeing that, said, I want a little easier trip than that. So he said, God, give me the strength and the tools to get to the other side. Poof, he was given a canoe. He got in the canoe, and it was a struggle, but he was able to make it to the other side. The third man said, I want a little easier trip than that. So he said, God, give me not only the strength and the tools, but give me the wisdom and the intellectual ability to get to the other side. Poof! He was made into a woman. She consulted the map, marched 200 yards upstream, and crossed the bridge. That pretty much summarizes the history of the church right there. So the women, of course, were the first ones at the empty tomb, and they were the ones to bring the message back. By the way, it's often pointed out by scholars that women of the first century were not allowed to be witnesses in court. You know, it had to be a man. And so for Matthew to say that the women were there, if he wanted to make it up, he would certainly have put men there, because that would have been more acceptable to the time in which he lived. But the women did it. And again, down through the centuries, it's been the women who lead us and get us to the right spot. Well, and then the earthquake. The earthquake kind of speaks to us of the power of God at work. Matthew probably, how am I going to describe this or what happened? It was such a powerful experience, this resurrection of Jesus, that an earthquake happened and the power was there. In our own lives, we need that earthquake power to be in our lives. As a matter of fact, the Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter 1, the first chapter of the letter to the Ephesians, says something to this effect. That resurrection power that raised Jesus from the dead now resides in us. Imagine that. That resurrection power that raised Jesus from the dead comes all the way to us and to our living and our dying and our loved ones living and dying and our diseases and our broken relationships and those things that we wish we could change. All of that is absorbed in this resurrection power, and new life is possible. That's the message of Easter. That's the beauty of it. Each Easter, I always think about those who have not had a full life on this earth. Last year, it was the Ukraine people, imagining them one day just having a normal life, and the next day, everything gets crazy. This year, I think about the little children in Nashville or Uvalde and many other places who all they do is they just go to school. Just go to school. And they're shot and killed. Is that it for them? Is that the final word? That's why I believe so much in Easter, because I cannot accept the fact that that's it for them. No fault of their own, they're just going to school of all things, and they get shot, and their life is cut completely short. There's got to be a future. There's got to be justice for all those children, for our firefighters who died locally. There's got to be. And that's why, for me, the resurrection power that raised Jesus from the dead resides in all of us and will bring us forth once again into new life. And that's why we're able to say, Christ is risen, Christ is risen again and again. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Let us join together in prayer. O God, on this Easter day, give us a glimpse of eternity. Enable us to see beyond our problems to possibilities, beyond this life to the next, and to think about those who have gone before us, our loved ones and friends, and those whose lives have been cut short, that we might have the faith and the insight to see that there is a future for them and for us. We bring before you those concerns that we have in our hearts, those problems, those issues. We know a lot about death. We know a lot about brokenness. We know a lot about all kinds of negative things. But on this Easter day, give us insight into the good and the future and the possibilities. We thank you for those who have joined our church family today, for Star and Sky, for their baptisms belonging now to you and to us and to this whole church family. Bless all of them, we pray, and use them here, that this might be a voice of love and justice for this community. And for the unspoken requests that we bring with us, we lift them up to you and ask that you would bring your resurrection power to them, to bring about change and newness. For we pray this through Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Come now to our morning offering. Appreciate everyone who has been supporting us, and I'll ask the ushers to come at this time. Thank you.
join me in the prayer of dedication. God of seekers and doubters, bless these gifts so that the world may know that you are always appearing. Bless our lives so that your love might appear in the work we share. Amen. Well, the words to This Is the Day are printed in your bulletin.
Thank you all for joining us today. Appreciate you coming on this Easter Sunday. We do have a time of fellowship next door. We invite you to that. We have some refreshments, some goodies to share. We also have the unveiling of our painting and the cards for sale. We have picture taking for all the beautiful ways you look today on this Easter Sunday. You can get your picture made as well. And hear now this benediction. Go forth to live boldly, as if death has no power over you. Live as if your lives count for something, because they do. God calls us in abundant love to serve something greater than our own finite lives, a greater cause for which we would even lay down our lives as Jesus did. For just as death on a tree could not stop the Christ, so our lives in service to God become larger than ourselves, part of an ever-inbreaking realm of God. Go in peace to love, to serve, and to proclaim. Christ is risen. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Amen.